like to make a call. Please hang up and try again.
Michelle Boat is accused of murdering Tracy Mondabough in May 2020. Boat's husband of two decades, Nicholas, had left Michelle months earlier and had established a relationship with the victim. Mondabough was found deceased from multiple stab wounds in a red truck belonging to Nicholas, outside their home on Glenwood Street in Pella, Iowa. Michelle Boat lived only a few minutes' drive away from the murder scene. The following documents the May 2021 trial.
Julian Kuiper, J-U-L-I-E, K-U-I-P-E-R.
Ms. Kuiper, are you able to hear me okay?
I am.
Ms. Kuiper, I'd like to direct your attention to May 18th of 2020. Can you tell the jury where you were living at that time?
Yes, 21 Glenwood Street, Pella, Iowa.
I'd like to focus on the evening hours of May 18th, 2020. Could you tell the jury what you were doing approximately 8 p.m. on May 18th, 2020?
Yes, I had just laid my son down for bed and gone out onto my back deck.
At some point, did you hear something that drew your attention?
Yes, I heard a commotion and a struggle going on in a vehicle.
Okay, could you describe where you saw this vehicle or what the vehicle looked like?
It was a maroon Ford pickup and it was directly in front of me.
Did you see any other vehicles near the red pickup?
Yes, I saw a silver gray four-door Cadillac parked at a diagonal or an angle behind the pickup.
How close in proximity was the Cadillac behind the red pickup?
I would say close to 3 or 4 feet.
Okay. I want to take you back to what you were observing at this time. Your Honor, we can take down State's Exhibit 5 at this point.
Go ahead.
Ms. Kuiper, you started to describe what you were hearing as you sat on your deck. Could you please describe to the jury in further detail what you saw and heard?
I heard a horn honk, and I could see two people, one person in the driver's seat of the truck and another person on the outside of the driver's door of the truck fighting. The person on the outside of the truck, I could see their, what I thought was punches, punching into the truck, and I could see the person that was in the driver's seat of the truck's upper torso coming over into the passenger seat of the truck. And it went back and forth. So every time there was like a punch, or I could see the upper torso coming over to the passenger side of the truck and then coming back up and then back down.
What are you doing at this moment?
Trying to decide if I needed to call the police.
At some point, did you see either of the people that you described earlier move away from the vehicle?
I did. I saw the person that had been standing on the outside of the truck come to behind the truck. And I saw them take their hand and push their hair up off of their forehead, and their hair stood up with blood, and then their face was all bloody.
Your Honor, just so the record is complete, the witness used her right hand to gesture towards her forehead and swiped upwards.
All right, the court will note that that's indeed what the witness did.
Ms. Kuiper, you described blood. Could you describe to the jury where you saw blood?
I saw blood all over the face of this person.
Can you describe this person to the jury, please?
They had hair, not quite shoulder length, and standing at a very wide stature, like almost like a Hulk or like a sumo wrestler, kind of a beefed up stance.
Could you tell if this person was male or female?
My impression was female.
You were describing her stance. Could you give any more detail to the jury about her body posture?
Just looked very hulked up, very arms kind of just in a very like a sumo wrestler, like you would think of, or like Hulk, kind of like just, you know.
Did you observe this person do anything with her hands?
I did. I saw their hand come up and saw something and heard something hit the cement. I throw something down and hit the cement because I heard it bounce, or I heard it, you know, I heard the noise that whatever was thrown hit the cement.
Were you able to observe the person who had been on the inside of the truck, what they were doing at this point?
They were not moving.
Could you describe what you saw to the jury, please?
There was just no movement. There was no movement. It was still inside the truck.
Would you please state your first and last name and spell both for the record?
Yes. Kody Roos, K-O-D-Y-R-O-O-S.
What do you do for a living?
I'm a full-time patrol officer for the Pella Police Department.
Can you tell us how long you've been with the Pella Police Department?
I've been there just over 2 years.
What is your educational background?
I graduated with a bachelor's degree in criminal justice from Dort College in 2013.
And what are your professional experiences?
While I was at Dort, I joined the Iowa Air National Guard, and I've been in for about 10 years now. Shortly after leaving Dort, I started full-time employment at the Primos Casino as a security officer. I left there to go work as a detention officer at the Polk County Jail. I spent almost 5 years doing that, and I left there to be a police officer in Pella.
I don't think so. Negative, fellas.
Officer, were you the first member of law enforcement or emergency response that responded to 101 Glenwood that evening?
Yes.
We see another officer arrive. Who is that?
That was Officer Brad Vincent.
Now, officer, when you respond to a scene like this, what's going through your mind?
Well, dispatch can only relay the information that they have. So for me responding to a scene, I understand that I don't know what's happened and what's happening. When I got there, my first priority is safety for myself and anybody else that might be responding, and then also assess the situation to see what happened, what's going on, to know what I'm walking up to. If I run too fast, it's hard for me to be able to render aid potentially. If I slip and fall, if there's a loose gravel or whatever. So my goal is to get there, assess the situation, and then also be able to call in, as you witnessed or watched, the ambulance, because I could tell it was a medical emergency and they're more trained to respond to that than I am.
Now, we saw you sprint back to your vehicle and move it as yes. One of the first things you did. Why did you do that?
I did that because the driveway was narrow and I wanted the ambulance to be able to get as close to the scene as possible and not have my vehicle be in the way.
You use the term AED.
Correct.
Do you know off the top of your head what the acronym means?
It's an automated external defibrillator.
And is that the device you had in your hands?
Correct, yes.
And how long does one in law enforcement do chest compressions for?
Until someone of higher authority takes over, which in this case was EMS or the ambulance.
At some point, were resuscitation efforts stopped?
Yes.
How does that happen in Pella, Iowa?
The ambulance crew calls to the hospital, and the hospital doctor on staff, they give the information of what they have, what they're seeing, and the doctor makes the call of whether or not to transport and continue. And it was decided to stop at that point.
Shane Cox, S-H-A-N-E-C-O-X.
What do you do for a living?
I am a police officer with the Pella Police Department.
Well, it looks like you're in a suit and the last guy was in a uniform. So what's your rank?
I'm a lieutenant.
How long have you been a lieutenant?
Since 2006.
Can you briefly tell us your professional background with the Pella Police Department?
I started in 2001 as a patrol officer and went through the Iowa Law Enforcement Academy shortly thereafter and worked briefly on the drug task force, and then in 2006 I was promoted to lieutenant over patrol.
Is there what is commonly recognized as a primary entrance to Vermeer or a controlled entrance to Vermeer?
Yes.
Where and how do you know what is the controlled entrance to Vermeer?
There's a building that sits next to Vermeer Road at that entrance that we refer to as the guard shack, and that's where security guards sit so that they can check people in and out. Normally, semi drivers have to stop and check in when they're delivering or taking something out, and so that would be the controlled entrance.
Lieutenant, could you see that guard shack as you described it on Exhibit 13?
Yes.
Could you place your the red dot on that spot? Your Honor, may the record reflect that the witness has identified the guard shack by placing a red dot to the north of Vermeer Road at the second turn-in from the left.
All right, the record will so reflect.
Sir, have you had a chance to review the videos of when Tracy Mondabough entered Vermeer property that evening, May 18, 2020?
Yes.
Which entrance did she use?
This entrance.
Which entrance was the defendant's Cadillac following her through?
This same entrance.
Sir, when they leave, which entrance do they leave from?
This entrance.
Your Honor, Lieutenant, does Vermeer have any type of specialized camera equipment?
Yes, they actually have upgraded their cameras quite significantly over the last couple years. They have a camera at that entrance that is placed on a barrier that's in the center of the road right there. And then they also have overview cameras all around their campus.
Sir, when you were mentioning the type of cameras that they have, do they have what you would commonly refer to as a license plate reader?
That's what I would refer to it as, yes.
Sir, I'm showing you States 18. Is that a still shot from Vermeer Corporation of the Cadillac that drove in behind the maroon truck on May 18th, 2020?
Yes.
And that photograph captures a license plate, does it not?
Yes.
As someone who reads license plates somewhat as a career, what do you make that license plate out to be?
HRX-595.
At some point during your investigation, did you determine whether or not Michelle Boat has a vehicle registered either in her or her husband's name that is a silver Cadillac?
Yes.
What is that license plate registered through the state of Iowa as being?
HRX-595.
At some point that evening, did you go to 101 Glenwood?
Yes.
Why did you do that?
When I heard the original call, normally a domestic situation is as far as officer safety goes, is unpredictable. So when I hear those types of calls, I make it a point to also go to those calls.
Did you make a determination to leave that 101 Glenwood and go somewhere else?
Yes.
Where did you go?
To 135 Prairie.
Why? What was the information you had that led you to go to 135 Prairie?
There were a couple different things. I spoke with a witness that was standing near the truck, and he explained or described a vehicle that had left the scene as a silver Cadillac. And in that same area, while I was there, I ran the registration plate on the maroon F-150. And shortly after I ran the plate through dispatch for the information that comes back when you do that, I was told by my dispatcher that the truck was registered to Nicholas or Michelle Boat.
And were you aware that a Nicholas and Michelle Boat also, when you ran it, also came back to having a Cadillac?
Yes.
When you arrive at 135 Prairie Street, what do you see?
The house from the street sits kind of uphill from the street. I saw the silver Cadillac sitting in the driveway to the south side of the house, and I could see that the window, the curtains or blinds were open on the front windows. I could see inside the residence.
I'm showing you Exhibit 17. Is that what you saw as you approached?
Minus the Pella Police Department tent, yes.
And just to deal with that issue, why is there a tent up?
This picture was taken later in the evening or early morning hours, and I believe that there was some weather that had been forecasted, and we were afraid that if it rained, that evidence that was on the vehicle would be destroyed.
Sir, were you wearing a body camera that night?
I was.
Was it recording as you approached the house?
Yes.
Thank you.
Pella entry. Pella, get in Zerker and find a phone number for Michelle Boat and call her and see if you can get her to answer. Nobody's come to the door. The rotors on the Cadillac are still hot, but nobody's coming to the door. I can see through most of the house and don't see anybody. Why don't you stay there and see if 77 needs help talking to any of the neighbors? I got 63 with me. We should be good. She's in this bathroom back here. I can see a little bit of movement, but I can't. The blinds are pulled.
Lieutenant, before we go any further, I want to do some translation for a second. We heard you use some words and some codes during that tape. What is Zerker? At some point you said, could you check Zerker?
Zerker is our in-house records management system, so a computer program that basically all of our cases, all of our calls for service, any information that we have on anybody goes into this program, and it's basically a database.
And at one point you said 63-8 is with you.
That is Lieutenant Bigowitz's badge number.
And then there was some other time that there was some traffic. I think you said something about tell 75 or 75 was called. What's going on there?
If I remember correctly, 85, which is Officer Wolf, was at Glenwood Street, and he called and asked if I wanted him to come to me on Prairie, and I told him to help 77, which was Detective Bailey at the time, and to see if he needed help talking to any of the neighbors on Glenwood. So a bunch of badge numbers.
Okay. After the video shuts off, what happens next?
And there's a pretty quick conversation, just kind of how it started right there at the end of the video about what's going on. I first asked Miss Boat to step out onto the front porch and then quickly realized she was in a robe and said, well, basically, since you're in a robe, do you mind if we step in and talk with you? And she invited us into the residence.
Officer, if I use the term that you cleared the house, what does that mean?
Basically, to do a cursory search of the house as far as making sure that there isn't somebody hiding in the residence that could do us harm, or it's an officer safety type thing that when you enter a residence and especially under these circumstances, I went through the house and made sure that there wasn't anybody else in the residence.
Did anything stand out to you when you cleared the house?
So it has had a finished basement, so I went down to clear the basement, and I believe at that time Lieutenant Bigouet and Miss Boat were in the kitchen. I went downstairs, and there was a storage area that was fairly long, and I could hear something from the back of the room. It was pretty dark. I had my flashlight. I made a couple announcements. Police department, if you're back there, come out. And nobody came out, so I continued forward, and once I reached the back of that area, I realized that the washing machine was running back there in the corner.
Sir, I'm showing you Exhibit 9. Is that the washing machine that you saw?
Yes.
Can you explain to the jury what was going on when you observed this washing machine?
Yes, the front window or the loading door there was probably about half full of water, and like sudsy water with soap, and then the round dial up in the center had a green number on it. I don't remember what the number was, but it was lit up green.
Officer, between the time that Julie Kuiper called Pella Police Department and the time you responded to the defendant's home, how much time had elapsed?
17 minutes.
Nicholas Don Boat, N-I-C-H-O-L-A-S, Don, D-O-N, Boat, B-O-A-T.
What town do you presently live in, Mr. Boat?
Pella, Iowa.
Where do you work?
Vermeer Corporation in Pella, Iowa.
How long have you worked at Vermeer?
7.5 years.
Are you familiar with the defendant, Michelle Boat?
Yes.
How long have you known Miss Boat?
21 years.
At some point, were you and Miss Boat married?
Yes.
Mr. Boat, I want to take you back to the beginning of 2020. Were you and Michelle still living together at the beginning of 2020?
Yes.
At some point, what address were you living at?
135 Prairie Street in Pella.
At some point in the beginning of March, did you and Michelle separate?
Yes.
Did you remain in the home after your separation?
No, I left.
Sometime after your separation from Michelle Boat, did you and Tracy move in together?
We did.
Where were you and Tracy living on May 18th, 2020?
101 Glenwood, apartment number 4 in Pella.
Do you recall about how long that you were with Tracy during your supper break?
It was between 7:35 and 8:08.
When you were with Tracy, did you notice any injuries to her at that time?
No.
Did you notice anything unusual about the inside of the pickup, such as any blood in the pickup?
No.
What did you do after you left Tracy?
I kissed her goodbye, and as I was walking back into the building, I waved to her and then went back into work.
Is that the last time that you saw Tracy Mondabaugh alive?
Yes.
Cross-examination?
Thank you. Mr. Boat, in May of 2020, you and Michelle had been married for 20 years?
Correct.
You had 2 children together?
Correct.
And on what date approximately did you begin your affair with Tracy?
It was towards the beginning of March.
That was through Facebook?
Correct.
And Michelle did not have access to your Facebook account, correct?
I did not have any passwords or anything that you couldn't get into, so I'm assuming she had access to it.
Do you remember when I took your deposition, Mr. Bowe?
Yes.
Do you remember me asking you that question?
No, I do not.
Mr. Bowe, did Michelle have access to your Facebook account?
Evidently, I did say no, but I did not have a password hooked up to it, so she could have gone into the computer at any point and opened my Facebook.
The only answer you gave me during your deposition to that question was no. Would you agree?
According to that piece of paper, yes.
And this piece of paper are the words from your deposition. Would you agree?
Yes.
And when you took that deposition, you were placed under oath.
That is correct.
And that's the answer that you gave to that question.
Evidently.
First name is Brian, B-R-I-A-N. Last name is Bigouet, B-I-G-A-O-U-E-T-T-E.
What do you do for a living?
I work for Ely Home Improvements.
When did that start?
Roughly March of this year.
What did you do before you worked for Ely Home Improvements?
Prior to that, I worked for the Marion County Sheriff's Office.
In what capacity?
I was retired as a lieutenant.
How long did you work in law enforcement?
I started with Marion County Sheriff's Office in 96 as a reserve, transitioned to full-time position in 1999, achieved the rank of lieutenant in 2013, which I held for 8 years until I just retired in January of this year, so 25 years total.
Now, Lieutenant Cox has already testified the jury has watched his body camera footage. Are you the other officer that's seen at some points during that footage?
Yes.
Was there anything in the kitchen of Michelle Boat's home that caught your attention?
Yes.
What was that?
A calendar on the wall.
Showing you what's been admitted as Exhibit 34. Is that the calendar?
Yes.
So, Lieutenant, what was so unique about a calendar in someone's kitchen that it caught your attention?
Well, oftentimes you see a calendar, you have things like people's birthdays, maybe appointments, things like that. This one, something significant had happened, obviously 69 days before May 18th, because someone in that residence has taken the time every single day, it appears, to document that every single day.
Now, when you went back to the defendant's residence and you saw that calendar, what was your role there that day?
That morning would have been the following morning, so the 19th. We were advised, we knew search warrants were being drafted to search the property. And we were advised 4:20, 4:30, somewhere in there in the morning, early morning, that the search warrant had been reviewed and approved and signed by the judge. So I was going in with other officers, more of a, to look for anything in evidentiary value, not really to seize anything or collect anything or photograph anything, just to walk through to see if there's anything that stood out that I would need to point out to any lab technicians that were collecting evidence. In the washing machine, as I commented earlier, when I was conversing with Lieutenant Cox outside the residence at Prairie Street after Michelle had been taken up to the police department to speak with the officers.
After Michelle
had been taken up, transported up to the police department to speak with investigators. He commented that it was a front load washer. He was downstairs and could see a load was spinning because he could see the clothes sloshing through the window. Of course, by 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, that was done. But I walked down there, and I didn't open it, but I could still see through the window, and it appeared to be an odd combination of articles or clothing inside.
What do you mean?
The materials or clothes inside the washer were not separated by any sort of type of clothing or color. It appeared to be one outfit. It looked like a pair of jeans, a darker zip-up coat, kind of, and a couple whites, like maybe possibly a bra or a sock.
What were you doing in the bathroom?
I wanted to look in there because when Lieutenant Cox and I first arrived on Prairie Street, it took, if you've watched the video, it took a seemed like a significant amount of time for somebody to come to the door. When Michelle did come to the door, she came from the bathroom. And having been at the scene and being briefed at the police department, there was a significant amount of blood at the scene. So I wanted to look in the bathroom to see if doorknobs, door handles, curtains, anything of that nature, if I could see any blood in the room.
Did you see any blood?
No.
Did something catch your attention?
Yeah, there were a couple things. One, there was no clothes on the floor. Either somebody got in the shower in a hurry and came out. There was no clothes or pile of clothes sitting there. I kind of thought about that. There was also a set of keys. Instead of being hung on a hook somewhere inside the door, there was a set of keys and a key fob laying on the vanity counter. And when I looked closer, there was, it looked like hair, dark colored hair, strung or wrapped up, caught up in it. And over those 2 or 3 minutes, or maybe even 4 minutes, while I was looking around the bathroom for any possible blood and noticed the other items, it dawned on me that the toilet kept running, but not all the time. It ran for 20, 30 seconds, and it would stop. And it ran, and just continually would run and stop and run and stop. So it caused me to go over to lift up the toilet lid, the tank, and that's when I observed a white towel in the tank of the toilet.
Showing you admitted exhibit 31, is that what you saw?
Yes.
Did you touch the towel?
No.
What did you do?
Not knowing if there maybe been a leak, somebody intentionally just put that towel there to keep water from spraying out. But I put the lid back on. I contacted the lab technicians that were at the residence and pointed that out to them and asked them maybe just take a look at that further before they cleared the residence that day.
My name is Elizabeth Miller, Elizabeth Miller.
What do you do for a living?
I am a special agent with the Division of Criminal Investigation.
Can you explain to the jury what it means to be a special agent?
So the DCI is a state law enforcement agency that assists local agencies with criminal investigations.
What else did you do?
In conjunction with the Pella Police Department, we would have completed follow-up interviews, executed search warrants, along with obtaining any surveillance footage from May 18th that would show either Tracy and or Michelle on that footage. In the first video, you will see the maroon F-150 entering the manufacturer lot with the silver Cadillac following a short time later.
Your Honor, we're showing Exhibit 76.
The video appears to only be a couple minutes long. However, this is Nick's lunch break. So in actuality, it's 25 to 30 minute time frame in between entering and exiting.
The parties stipulate and agree that Nick Boat returned to work shortly after 8:08 p.m. from taking his evening dinner break. Stipulation 5 is that the parties stipulate and agree that both Tracy Mondabough and Michelle Boat leave the Vermeer parking lot on May 18, 2020 at 8:09 p.m. Ma'am, what's the next video we're going to see?
It's the last video from the Vermeer manufacturing lot of both the F-150 and the silver Cadillac leaving the lot.
And are they in fact leaving from the same turn-in that they entered from?
Yes.
Ma'am, in general, as you look back on this investigation, how many witnesses were interviewed in total?
Around 20 witnesses.
How many physical pieces of evidence were collected?
About 60.
And how many pieces of physical evidence were sent to the crime lab?
About 40 pieces of evidence.
Kelly Cruz, K-R-U-S-E.
How are you employed?
I am an associate state medical examiner at the Iowa Office of the State Medical Examiner.
What do you do? What are your duties in that role?
We perform autopsies to determine cause and manner of death. Once I perform an autopsy, I create an autopsy report, which documents all of my findings. I then speak to family members, talk about my findings. I testify in court as an expert witness. I also interpret toxicology findings in relevant cases. Once that external examination is performed, we then perform an internal examination. So the internal examination involves, it's a surgical sort of Y-shaped incision on the front of the torso. We then reflect the skin, we'll take off the chest plate, the ribs and the sternum, and we'll look at each organ, we'll take each organ out, we'll weigh it, and we'll inspect it for any sort of natural disease or any sort of injury. We'll also take the brain out and look at that as well. During that internal examination process, we also gather a number of different fluids for toxicology testing. We'll take vitreous fluid, which is fluid from the eyes. We'll take blood, and we'll take urine if that's available. Once that internal examination process is complete, we'll then take the organs, put them back in the body. We'll close our surgical incision, and then the body is released to the funeral home for final disposition. So this is a photograph of the left side of her face. What's most obvious just looking at that, she has a number of abrasions or sort of scratch type injuries scattered across the left side of her face. So these are these red marks here and here. And these are indicative of impacts with a blunt object, which essentially scraped off the top of her skin. We can also see on the left side of her face, she has a cutting wound, which is an injury with a sharp object. And this is right here next to her left nostril, sort of C-shaped injury. She also has some small contusions or bruises. One is most obvious here on the corner of her left eye.
What about over her left eyebrow?
Over her left eyebrow here is another abrasion or sort of scrape. So this is a photograph of the left side of her chest or the left breast region to the right of the ruler right here. This is a stab wound of the superior portion of her left breast. Once I reflected back the tissue, I was able to appreciate that the stab wound injured the left breast tissue. It then went through a rib and then entered into the left side of her chest. Once it was in that left chest cavity, it entered the pericardial sac or the sac that's around the heart, and the stab wound also injured the heart itself.
What did you determine what trajectory that wound took through her body?
He was. So in terms of what we call anatomic position, that's a person standing straight, looking straight ahead with their palms facing forward. The direction or the trajectory of the stab wound was front to back, left to right, and downward.
And that is also consistent with the organs that the knife penetrated in this wound.
Yes.
Was this the fatal injury in this case?
Yes, this wound is fatal.
Carl Franzenberg, K-A-R-L-F-R-A-N-Z-E-N-B-U-R-G.
What was your occupation until relatively recently?
I was a trace evidence examiner at the Iowa DCI Crime Laboratory.
And why is it no longer your occupation?
I retired.
When did you retire?
I retired on March 31st of this year.
All right. What is the trace evidence division at the DCI Crime Lab?
Trace evidence examination is the examination, identification, and comparison of non-biological materials, for instance, fibers, paint, glass, any types of physical objects that may be involved in a criminal investigation.
And how long were you employed as a criminalist at the DCI lab with respect to trace evidence?
About 15 years in trace evidence, and the rest of the time, 31 and a half years in drug chemistry and blood and breath alcohol.
Is fracture matching a subset of work that people in the trace evidence division do at the lab?
Yes, it is.
What is fracture matching?
It's basically putting puzzle pieces together.
All right. In your role as a criminalist in the trace evidence division, did you do some fracture matching work in this case?
Yes, I did.
What did you do it upon?
I examined a blue rubber glove that was missing one finger, and I compared that to a blue rubber finger.
Those records indicate that the full glove missing the finger came from a toilet tank, and the finger came from the scene, one of the scenes in this case. Does that refresh your recollection?
Yes, that does sound accurate to me.
All right. So what did you do to fracture match these items?
I placed the finger over a cylinder to simulate having been on a finger, and I also placed that same cylinder through the hole in the glove where the finger is missing and placed those under a stereo microscope so I could photograph them.
All right. I'm going to display State's Exhibit 62. Is this one of the photographs that you took during the process that you just described?
Yes, it is.
Can you explain for the jury what we're seeing then?
On the right-hand side of the photograph is the finger, and on the left-hand side of the photograph is the rest of the glove. And the white streak in the middle is that's the white cylinder in the background.
Right. And the next exhibit, 63, is a slightly closer-in picture of the same two items of evidence, is it not?
Yes, it is.
Can you point out any indications, and you should have, I'll give you control, there's a mouse ahead of you, and I've now given a laser pointer. If you could just point out some areas of matching or not matching these two fractured items of evidence.
The first one is right here where there's a little bump, and on the other side of the break is an opening the same size and shape of the bump on the left, and working down towards the right, there's another similar tear in the fabric. They both have the same shape, they both have the same size of the break, and leading up to the right a little bit where it curves down again, that's all detail that matches from the glove to the finger.
Based upon your experience and training and the analysis that you've just briefly described, were you able to reach a conclusion to a reasonable degree of professional certainty as to whether these two separate items of evidence were once formed into a single glove?
My conclusion is that that finger came from that glove.
First name Ryan, last name Petruccelli. It's PETRUCCELLI.
How are you employed?
I'm employed at the Iowa Division of Criminal Investigation, Criminalistics Laboratory.
And in what division do you work at the DCI Crime Lab?
I work in the DNA section.
How long have you worked there?
Since December or April 2015.
Could you tell the jury a little bit about your educational background that qualify you for the job that you do?
So I have a bachelor's of science degree with a major in biology and a minor in forensic science from Western Illinois University.
What specialized training, if any, do you have in the area of DNA analysis?
So I've been doing DNA casework for about 3.5 years. I had to go through about a 9-month training program at the DCI lab. I also have to attend at least one or two external trainings a year. This could range from conferences to seminars to lectures, just covering the field of forensic DNA. With COVID, a lot of it's kind of online presentations now.
Have you previously testified as an expert in the area of DNA analysis?
Yes, I have.
Did you examine hair from a truck steering wheel, which is item six, lab item number six?
Yes, I did.
Were you able to develop a DNA profile from that hair?
Yes, I ran three root ends of three hairs, and I got profiles on two out of the three.
All right. Did that DNA profile from the root ends of two of those hairs match either of your known DNA profiles?
Yes, one was consistent with Michelle Boat, and the other one matched Michelle Boat.
And I notice you've used different terms. Do you, when you do your work, put a numerical likelihood calculation associated with a particular DNA comparative result?
Yes, we put a probability to it.
All right. What was the probability as to the one that you said was consistent with the DNA profile, known DNA profile of Michelle Beau?
So the probability of finding this profile in a population of unrelated individuals chosen at random would be less than 1 out of 14 octillion.
And that, how big is an octillion?
So an octillion is about 1 followed by 27 zeros, kind of in comparison to the world population, which is about 7.5 billion. Billion is 1 followed by 9 zeros.
Hair that was collected from Tracy Mondabaugh's left hand, your lab exhibit item number 8. Did you perform a comparative analysis of that hair or of the DNA from the root end of one of those hairs?
Yes, I examined 7 of them and I processed 2 of them for DNA analysis.
With what result?
The first hair cutting of the root end matched the known DNA profile of Tracy Mondabaugh, and the probability of finding this in a profile of population of unrelated individuals chosen at random would be less than 1 out of 6.6 octillion. The other hair, the cutting from the root end of the other hair, matched the known DNA profile of Michelle Boat, and the probability of finding this profile in a population of unrelated individuals chosen at random would be 1 out of 260 octillion.
1 out of 260 octillion, is that what you said?
That's correct.
All right.
was one of the evidentiary items that you examined swabs from the silver Cadillac, item number 9, lab item number 9, and from the passenger side mirror of the silver Cadillac?
Yes.
All right. What was the result of your analysis of the blood on the passenger side mirror of the silver Cadillac?
So the DNA profile developed from the swabs of the passenger side mirror matched the known DNA profile of Tracy Mondabough. And the probability of finding this profile in a population of unrelated individuals chosen at random would be less than 1 out of 6.6 octillion.
Did you also examine hairs collected from the inside driver door of the silver Cadillac, item number 10, lab item number 10? Or actually two hairs from that location.
Yes, I examined two hairs, and the profiles from both of those hairs match the known DNA profile of Tracy Mondabough.
With what statistical probability of it being another matching DNA profile?
And the probability of finding this profile in a population of unrelated individuals chosen at random would be less than 1 out of 6.6 octillion.
Next, did you examine an FTA card created from the pelleted liquid obtained from the red water from the with a blue glove in the toilet tank, of a toilet tank? Did you perform a DNA analysis of that FTA card?
Yes, I did.
What was your finding?
So screening indicated the presence of blood on the pelleted liquid that I swabbed the FTA card with, and the DNA profile developed from a cutting of the FTA card indicated a mixture of two individuals, and the profile of the major contributor matched the known DNA profile of Tracy Mondabough. And the probability of finding this profile in a population of unrelated individuals chosen at random would be less than 1 out of 6.6 octillion.
In the matter of the state of Iowa versus Michelle Lee Bowe, we, the jury, find the defendant guilty of murder in the first degree, verdict form number 1. Is that your verdict, members of the jury?
Yes.
So say all of you?
Yes.
Does the state request a polling of the jury?
No, sir.
Does the defense?
No, sir.